Hello there, this is Dr. Samurai, a professor in Japan specializing in international social pathology, which is needed much, much more today than other ages, seeing all those confusions in the world today. And the topic of my minute lecture today is Mr. Matt Hale of creativity. I think the word creativity as religion is known by relatively fewer people. It was started in 1973 by Mr. Ben Klassen as the Church of the Creator at the Lighthouse Point in the state of Florida. And its core teaching, I believe, is unification of nature and God. That I think means, like, you know, nature is actually the God. No? And it denies Christianity, Judaism, and it emphasizes the eugenic status of white people. By the way, the term creator is and was often used by Hitler to mean the class that dominates and control other races. And in 2003, this Church of the Creator was renamed as the World Church of the Creator by Mr. Matt Hale. And this creativity is promoted by two organizations now. One is the Creativity Alliance, and the other is the Creativity Movement. These are the two engines which promote creativity. If I add one more thing, the members of the movement believe in a racial holy war between white and Jews and black and non-white people of mixed race or mixed races. That is pretty much the information about creativity. And it is now considered one of the neo-Nazi movement. And Mr. Matthew Hale. I usually call him Reverend Hale or Reverend Matthew because it is a church and which he prefers to be called. But the biggest difference from other neo-Nazi movement is he denies Christianity and he accepts Darwin's, you know, theory of evolution and eugenic status of white people. So those two, evolution and, you know, white people being eugenic. This mixture is the very core of this creativity religion. And although Reverend Matthew has earned his license as an attorney, he is an attorney. His license is, you know, blocked from being used because he is promoting the separation of races and causing, I think, public danger. So that's why he cannot act as lawyer now. In 2005, it is said, it is alleged that Reverend Matthew asked undercover FBI investigator to murder a federal judge. And for that, he received a sentence that lasts till 2037, which is 17 years ahead. Okay? And now I would like to get into Reverend Matthew that I know. I found out later that Reverend Matthew also had certain level of respect for Japanese tradition, which I was very appreciative for. And, this might be out of this context, but the more thug friends I came to know and have our understanding deepened, I have learned that there are, this must be out of this context a little bit, but having started this study that I am doing now, I came to learn there are much more people around the world who respect what our ancestors of honorable spirit did during the World War II. Although the direction of the war and the reason of the war, I never affirm and I never consider positive. I am kind of appreciative to know that there are so many people all around the world who know there were young people who were ready to die to try to protect this country and their family, you know, during that terrible era in exchange for their own life. It's like now there are fewer and fewer Japanese who really appreciate Japanese culture and tradition. There are more and more, you know, foreign people who have interest and appreciate Japanese traditional culture, stuff like that. So it's kind of ironical, you know, but I do appreciate people outside finding out this value of what we have created traditionally. Anyway, let's get back to what we are talking about. In general, the philosophy of white supremacy is taken for being pathological hate and obsession with their existing privilege. But the theory that Mr. Reverend Matthew teaches does not start out with the story of Adam and Eve, but it straightforwardly accepts the theory of evolution. He pays high respect to nature and natural providence. So, for example, it is like a Japanese dog should stay in Japan, German shepherd should be in Germany, and the same thing can be said about, human location. Each human race should be where the nature intended them to be. Do you understand what I'm saying? And for the same reason, he is a vegetarian, because human beings being part of monkeys, it is against natural providence for humans to eat meat. You know, it is unnatural, he thinks. So he sometimes writes to me saying that I just miss that biting into the fresh vegetables and fruits, which is on the natural plant. I think I can share that feeling. And also, he is pretty much open-minded to listen to others, you know. Although in the beginning I mentioned members are interested in racial war against all the other races and stuff. That includes Japanese too, right? But he is not like that. And I kind of think, you know, another reason why Japanese are not hated so much is we stay on the islands of Japan and don't move out to live in another land. So we are pretty much self-contained, and I think that gets along with those who respect racial philosophy. But anyway, as you may know it better than I do, white philosophy is divided into largely two main groups. One is white supremacy, and the other is racial separation, in which different race should live in different designated areas. Reverend Matthew seems to support the latter idea, that different race in the United States should live in a designated different area, separated from each other. This is not my idea. This is Reverend Matthew's idea, okay? He is very proud that it is pretty much white races that promoted the modern civilization up to this current level. This leads to the, you know, eugenic philosophy of white people, I think. But at the same time, I think, you know, does this idea sort of spread among black people, that white people never do things themselves and always use other races to do things. So these are the kind of images white people and black people have on each side. When Mr. Matthew was a little kid, their parents were always fighting, and probably because of that, his older brother kept bullying on him. And he said that one of the reasons he went into the world of philosophy is to have inner peace by reading and being absorbed in what is written in the book, apart from what surrounds his reality at home, you know. And among so many books he escaped into, Mein Kampf by Adolf Hitler gave him a very powerful impact. And he gradually, and later he came across Mr. Ben Klassen's creativity philosophy, which accepts evolution theory to explain everything apart from Christianity. And in my understanding, for Reverend Matthews, living under domestic confusions and oppressions, having found this satisfactory theory of creativity that can explain everything satisfactorily, became a very important part of his spiritual backbone to survive such domestic disadvantageous conditions. His father used to be a police officer. He often talked about over the bridge, there are too many problems caused by black people. He said that when he came back from his work casually. So that also unconsciously gave Mr. Matthew some kind of a negative image about black people. And that was imprinted deeply into his psychology since it happened during his childhood. Based upon my multiple experiences, I think I can say two things. One is like that person's parent has a certain fixed idea about race. They taught their own idea down to their children, who those children actually sees and experience what they heard from their parents in their real life, that philosophy about the race seems to be solidified. And two, when a child is living under not necessarily ideal condition, which he could not control by himself, you know, out of control environment in childhood, such child have tendency to obsess with the aggressive, exclusive, fundamental, solid ideology and obsess with it as the basis for their survival from their difficult, abusive childhood. These two things, you know, down from their parent to survive from abusive childhood that he cannot control, you know. They are placed under such conditions. They feel like finding something of his own, which is never invaded and messed with by others, to feel security, to confirm security, to keep on going. You understand, right? I think creativity was something like that to Reverend Matthew. Although it all depends on who you are, those who tend to have white supremacy philosophy, they prefer, you know, malicious, unkind, even criminal white people than good and honest and hardworking and supportive black people. This is a kind of a strange thing when you hear it by words. But if you were placed under abusive conditions during your childhood, which you could never control by yourself, you need to draw line, and you have to sort out your living image, your psychological image of outside, by drawing clear line, even if it is possible. To live through stormy childhood, you must draw clear line to survive. During such period, you could not afford to pay attention to subtle inside. Only thing you can see is the outside, and that outside is, as long as that outside is simple and clear, you can obtain certain level of serenity and psychological peace, you know. So he thought he found the one, the creativity, and he devoted all himself to this cause, and he succeeded to leading position of the organization. And interesting thing is, now he has found one for which he can devote himself 100%. Their parents, who used to fight against each other every day, are now both supportive to his cause and back in a good relationship, or at least a better relationship than before. And the reason why Reverend Matthew and I could get along with each other very well was we share the same understanding that following the natural rule and providence is highly important. Since we are all born as part of nature, and we will all go back to be part of nature, you know. So we share the rule that controls our mother nature is the one of the most important thing to live peaceful life on this earth. And remember, I mentioned in the very beginning that he was caught by trying to ask this undercover police officer to kill the judge. He didn't mention that at all, at least in our correspondences. I asked him, why did you get arrested? And he answered, while he was a college student, he was handing out papers that explains the importance of sticking to white supremacy on campus. And the security guard came, and it developed into some kind of a quarrels. And Matthew insisted that what's wrong with just passing out papers peacefully? And he You know, he swore to me once and again that he never even raised his finger. He never used violence against that black security guard. However, the report was made in a distorted form that he resorted to some kind of violence towards that black security guard, and he was arrested for that. So that is why he said he was fighting so hard to be innocent. No, he is fighting to be innocent, you know, because he believes he is innocent. This is my guess, but probably he was already marked as a dangerous person in terms of public safety. He was, I guess, on the list that if he caused any kind of problem one more time, he has to go. Stuff like that, you know, as American people know it as part of yourself. But so many tourists who visit America, they come in groups and stay at the same hotel in group and spend a lot of money to buy souvenirs to the people waiting in their country. And most of them go back to their country thinking that what a flashy, great country America is. And their understanding doesn't go deeper than that because they don't even speak English to communicate about deeper aspects of the society. And it's not necessary for a tourist either. But I'm sorry, I just woke up, so I'm kind of thirsty. Especially after 9/11, all those, you know, national agencies like FBI, CIA, ICE, and DHS, they set their radars ready. If you touch the radar, you will be taken in, even if you did not cause any problem or you did not, you know, commit any crime, and you will be detained or you are rejected when you try to re-enter the United States. Under Trump administration, I think everybody saw the aspect of America, which is not as free and equal as you have been hearing, but more exclusive, very strict as a police nation, especially now because of this subtle world situation. Anyway, at this moment, Reverend Matthew is 49 years old, and he is supposed to be out in 2037. So, in a simple calculation, if he keeps being a model inmate, he can be out in his 60s, which is still young, considering everybody's talking about life is now 100 years, you know, 40 years more he can have outside if things go as is promised. At the present, Reverend Matthew is orchestrating his evangelism with his prison cell as the center of church in practice. I think he is great, especially when he said, I am now working for something bigger and more important than myself. So some years of my incarceration is not such a big problem, considering the importance of this cause I am in. There was no crowdiness when he said those words to me. This is pretty much it, you know. I provided the facts so that you can think about contents by yourself. And I think these information help deepen your understanding of, I'm not sure this word is correct, but the neo-Nazi, you know, And this will be your assignment to think over up until next time we get together. Okay? Thank you very, very much for listening my minute lecture. Okay, you have a wonderful time. Okay? Bye-bye now.